In the first video, I talked about how I approached this challenge and some of the thoughts and ideas I had. I'd like to emphasize again that I worked on this for both days of the CTF, so I cannot include every small detail and struggle I had, but I hope I showed the important steps. At some point, I was looking closer at the deployed contracts, bytecode, and transactions and noticed that the hard-coded logger address of the game contract was wrong. And so early on the second day, I went to the organizers and told them that. I thought all my attack ideas didn't work because of that. However, the author then kinda dropped a hint because he said, "Oh, but it doesn't really matter. The exploit doesn't need the logger contract." And I was like, "What the F? This is all just distraction? All the function signature collision, all the delegate call stuff here, all just unimportant? F my life." He then also announced this hint publicly over the microphone so that the competition stays fair and everybody knew about that as well. But for me, this meant back to square one. I was so lost. Out of desperation, also because I knew the trick must be here in the game contract, I decided to reverse engineer the deployed game contract binary code more closely, which I got through calling getCode when attached to the Web3 API. Together with a teammate, we were looking over the opcodes and stumbled over a backdoor in the answers function. Oh shit. So here's the call graph of this contract in Binary Ninja using the Etherplay plugin from Trail of Bits. If you go into the answerIs function, follow it down, you find the first check. This is the isHuman check where it looks at the code size. Following further the execution, you reach some code that contains a SHA-3 opcode, so that's the CacheAct256 call. So here it calculates the hash of your supplied answer and compares it to the stored hash. After that, we find another condition where the call value, so the ether you sent along the transaction, is compared to hexDEOB blah blah. So this checks if you sent one ether. So far so good. It's exactly what you see in the contract code. But then we find a check on call data size. So this is the input data you sent with your transaction. This input contains the function signature you want to call, including the parameters serialized. And that size has to be hexA0. If that is not the case, which is the normal case for this function, then you see here how the hard-coded address of the logger is loaded, it checks the external code size of the logger and either reverts, this is by the way what happened last video when we played with the remix debugger, or everything is fine. But there are two weird things. First of all, this code does not include the transfer of the ether if you win. It's simply not there in the bytecode. And instead we have this check of the input size, which was not in the Solidity source. So if the code size is hexA0, the caller address, so our address if you get here, is loaded onto the stack. FFFF is pushed onto the stack. Then a binary AND is executed, which leaves only the last two bytes of the address, and then it uses that value and performs a jump. This is the backdoor. You have here an arbitrary jump that you can control with the last two bytes of your address. The question is just, where do you want to jump now? And this is what I basically spent most my time on during the second day. In Ethereum, you can't just jump anywhere. You can only jump to addresses where there is a jump dest instruction, which you see all over the place. So while there are a limited amount of places you can jump to, it's still a lot. And I just knew it wouldn't be one single jump. It probably must mean you have to chain multiple jump gadgets together. It's like ROP, or more like JOP, jump-oriented programming, but in an Ethereum smart contract. So this means you have to find and reuse code that is already there to send away the ether to your account. But the only transfer we know about from the original source was missing in the backdoor binary code. You can only send ether away with something like a call instruction, so opcode F1, or with a delegate call, opcode F4. While there were a few F1 calls, nothing looked good. But during this research, I also found this bzz string. And when you disassemble that, then there is a jump dest. So you can jump here and there is a delegate call. What the F? Through a bit of research about the bz string, I learned that this belongs to metadata the Solidity compiler appends at the end of smart contracts, encoding of the metadata hash in the bytecode. And the challenge author made it so that the 32 bytes swarm hash contains a jump dest and a delegate call. This cannot be a coincidence. I swear this was done on purpose to hide a gadget. Problem was though that jumping here right away doesn't work because the parameters that are needed on the stack for the delegate call don't match. It will run into an error. So we need to jump somewhere else first, but I'm sure we must jump here at some point. One other small thing I found out was from disassembling the contract creation code, which is sent along the contract creation transaction and is different from the actual deployed contract on the blockchain. It contains the constructor code. So all this code actually deploys the backdoor contract, but at the end we reach this jump relative to the program counter. And so we can calculate where it jumps to and disassemble the code there, and it's very short. It simply pushes these 4 bytes on the stack, pushes another byte identifier on the stack, and then stores this 4-byte value in the contract storage at this key. For whatever reason, I looked up these 4 bytes in a big database of Solidity function signatures, and it turns out this matches the function signature for withdraw. Again, must not be a coincidence. One other thing I also remembered were those weird characters in this one string. I also assumed these must have purpose, and because these hard-coded strings are just in regular code of the smart contract, I assumed it contains Ethereum bytecode. And there was actually a jump dest. The opening bracket is 5b, the opcode for jump dest. So I thought we could jump there. I assumed that must be a gadget. And this is as far as I got during the CTF. The last struggle I had was fighting with that I just couldn't jump there. It would always fail even though there was a jump dest. I was so sad but also learned so much more about reversing. I later realized the problem was that the Ethereum VM saw this as part of a large push 32. The 5B is in there and the EVM doesn't allow to jump into the middle of an instruction. But after the CTF, I really wanted to talk to the challenge author because I wanted to understand how to solve it. So let me introduce you to him. But don't be fooled by his good looks. This is the face of pure evil. He's a maniac who made me spend probably 50 hours or more on this challenge. He answered some of my questions, which was really nice, and he was really happy that I enjoyed the challenge so far. He told me it took him a week to create it and that it was the hardest challenge he could come up with. Yeah, I believe that. One of the things he told me, and I didn't notice that the weird string appeared twice in the backdoor contract further down. There are a few bytes different, and so here there were invalid commands, and so the jump dest was in the clear and reachable. Dang it. Well, after the CTF was over, after I talked to the challenge creator, I also talked to the only team that solved it, 217. But unfortunately, the person who solved it was not on site, and they only knew that there was a backdoor, which I already knew. The small technical details were what I was struggling with. So I was still so obsessed for not having solved this challenge that back in the hotel after the CTF, during our over 24-hour trip back to Germany, in the train home, and then more hours at home, I just had to pwn this damn contract. At this point, it wasn't about fun anymore. It was pure self-loathing, driven by the hate about my stupid little brain who just cannot solve this damn challenge. My own obsession and owning it to my team members for having spent all the time on this did not allow me to give up. Anyway, I solved it. Finally. About a week after the CTF, the challenge finally fell. I'm free again. Before I walk you through that, I just want to mention and share a few notes on my experience testing and debugging smart contracts. I never really had to debug smart contracts beyond simply debugging with Remix. So this complex setup of the backdoor contract and stuff like that was new to me. For most of the time during the CTF, I was just using this EVM program to run the code and debug it, but there were a lot of these checks like answering the question correctly, which I couldn't figure out how to do. So I basically always patched the binary bytecode to ignore those checks. So that was very cumbersome. Eventually, I realized I need more of a dynamic debugging environment, and that's when I went through the trouble and used Geth to run my own local environment and deployed the contracts there. I will link all my deploy and setup scripts in the description so you can just do the same. This is very cleaned up code, but it was obviously very messy during the CTF. I basically just replay all the contract creation inputs that I extracted with a simple transaction logger. However, because I don't have the private key of the real admin, my contract addresses will be different. So a lot of the hard-coded values like the logger address and the function calls had to be adjusted. Oh, and I also added a few different accounts in the Genesis block so we have Ether there to deploy the contracts. By having this local Ethereum chain running with Geth, we can also expose the debug API, which allows us to retrieve a detailed execution trace of transactions. So I could try to trigger the backdoor and then request a trace and look through what happened. I also wrote a small Python script to just filter and more nicely display the important checkpoints of the trace. I really wish Remix would support that. One other detail that is important is that I forgot about the A contract, which calls start on B, which serves as a distraction because the real address for B is passed in dynamically, and I knew already that it passes the address of the game contract, so it calls start on Aquareda Monica game. So I forgot that in my local deployment script and only had the second transaction that calls start directly, but that one used a longer answer. And the problem was that this longer answer was then the correct one for my local test, and the way the backdoor worked meant that the answer reached into one address used as a jump gadget. Blah blah, I just got stuck there. Theoretically, I knew that the A contract was there, which also called start, but I forgot about it. And that contract was actually using the same question, but just used a single character as an answer. And it was executed first. So that meant to answer the question correctly to trigger the backdoor, the answer was short, and in reality there was never a problem with the long answer. But that little mistake cost me probably another 8 to 16 hours of running in circles, trying to find another backdoor or using the existing backdoor to somehow set a short new answer, and then in a second stage do the actual exploit. But that was wrong because, like I said, I'm so dumb and forgot about the A contract. So the purpose of the A contract was another obfuscation trick used by the author, because this transaction doesn't immediately look like on first sight like it would call start, but it actually does in the constructor. Long story short, the real answer for the question is just a single R, and the second call to start was just a distraction and at the same time a way to transfer the ether we have to steal to the contract. Anyway, this is the final payload. The whole attack actually requires an additional contract, an attack contract, that I have to deploy first, but let's look at the contract once we reach that step. Now just lean back and enjoy the ride of what this input does. This sends one transaction with one ether using this payload as input to the Aquareda Monica game contract. So first of all, we see the function signature that is being used. Hex F6A3EC67, so that's just calling the answerIs function. We can follow this here in Binary Ninja. Then comes the isHuman check, but this is a normal transaction, so no contract, so perfectly fine. After that we get the SHA-3 calculation again, and the equal, and we know from the obfuscated start call that our answer is just 1 byte long, a single R. After that it checks the call value, so if we send 1 ether, and that is also fine. Next we check the call data size. It has to be hex A0, so 160 bytes long, and yes, I made the payload exactly 160 bytes long. That's why there is a bit of padding. And now we enter the backdoor code. It takes my address, applies the FFFF, and leaves the last 2 bytes of my carefully chosen address, hex FE6. I wanted to jump there because we identified that as an interesting gadget earlier inside of the weird string here. And so I wrote a small script to brute force a private key until I get these 2 last bytes. So this private key that we use for this transaction has this public address. Anyway, this means we continue execution in our first jump gadget at hex 5e6. This gadget was carefully created by the author and it prepared the parameters for the delegate call gadget I showed you earlier. So for example, this will actually load a function signature from the contract storage at 262A, which if you remember was set at the injected constructor code. So this actually loads the function signature of withdraw. It also calls callDataLoad to load the address of the target contract from our input and puts it into the stack. So the address here in my input is actually the contract that is being called if we execute the delegate call. And this is how the stack in the end looks like. This whole gadget inside the string is just to prepare the stack carefully. So this is the gas for the transaction, the target address, and then some parameters that define the input data. So the withdrawal function signature. And the other call data loads the next jump address, also from the input. It's this value here. And this is also where the error happened that caused me to run in circles. If the answer would be super long, the answer would reach into here. And because the Ethereum VM works on 32 byte values, that jump address was obviously completely wrong. But now it's all fine. And this address for this jump here points at the delegate call gadget we found in the contract metadata, which the compiler placed there. We jump there and execute the delegate call. So this will call now into the contract I defined here. Now let me show you this attack contract I mentioned at the beginning. This is how it looks like. It simply defines here the player and the game contract address. And then we have the withdraw function that it wants to call. So this will be called. And it's simple, it just performs a transfer with the balance of the game contract. So all the ether from the game contract and transfers it to our player account. This works because of the delegate call. A delegate call is a special call, which basically means you still operate in the environment of the original contract, but execute the code of the other contract. So if we delegate call this withdraw function and do a transfer, it's as if the game contract would have done the transfer directly. So that allows us to send the ether away. But to make sure this transaction actually happens, we have to ensure that the code doesn't run into an error and reverts. So you probably wonder what this weird huge return value is, but it's carefully chosen. So when we return from the delegate call, it will load another jump destination onto the stack, which when debugging, we can see jumps to hex 49D. And there we see a load which actually loads the return value from the delegate call and then performs an add. If we hadn't returned a value, or for example, when you do a self-destruct instead of a transfer, which I originally tried, this would be a zero. We would perform hex 4b1 plus zero and jump to 4b1. And that would then continue in the original execution flow with the logger contract, and then eventually it will run into a revert. So to avoid that, we have to return a value from the call so that when it adds the return value on 4b1, it will actually jump somewhere where the contract gracefully stops and commits all the transactions. So like a clean exit in a ROP chain. And so here we just do an integer overflow with the add of FFFBE7, or more like a subtraction of hex minus 419. And the result is hex 98. Jumping there means it leads to 99, and this is where it stops. Boom. Now the blockchain recorded the transaction of all the ether from the game contract to the player contract. Here I queried the balance of the game contract before and here afterwards. F yeah, the game contract is empty and we won. This was probably the hardest CTF challenge I have solved in a long time. And some of you might think that this was a waste of time to spend dozens of hours on this. I can't really show everything in these videos, but you have to remember that I didn't know all what I explained before, and I gained so much practical experience and insight into the Ethereum VM. I kinda understood smart contracts before, but now I really understand them. And I got very comfortable reading EVM bytecode and working with it. This was incredibly helpful to me. As I mentioned somewhere else briefly, because I do some smart contract audits professionally, this also helps me to do an even better job. This challenge was a perfect example how I use CTFs to help me advance my professional career on the technical level.